On this episode of Built to Last, we are starting from the bottom up with a better understanding of foundations. First, we'll look at robotic total station technology. It's state-of-the-art for surveying. I'll walk you through some formwork options, and then we'll take you to a job site where pile driving is the work of both man and machine. It's time to get started next on Built to Last. Hi, I'm Bruce Obora. The building trades are constantly working on best practices for construction. Today, with a great deal of consideration to sustainability and raw materials, a natural next step is to let technology lend a hand in building a strong foundation. Starting with the layout, most modern construction involves a tool called total station. Before total station technology, a carpenter would use a transit, which is basically a telescope and rod. At work today are robotic total stations that can map out a whole room. Let's take a look.
The new technology allows the instrument to track not only standard prisms or reflective surfaces like any total station, but it's allowing the operator to lay out in the field utilizing a laser point rather than having to rely on a rod and a prism. So this is increasing the productivity rates for all layout for interior purposes as well as exterior. So any contractor for any trade has the ability to use this in the field now to lay out any point of interest, whether it's in a 3D model, a 2D model, or just from a blueprint. They can efficiently lay out any point inside of that drawing or inside of that area of interest accurately with confidence. They have the choice to either build directly from a blueprint and input it by hand, utilizing a program inside the data collector or the device that allow them to input their dimensions from scratch, or they can input in a DWG or DXF drawing from an AutoCAD file, or they can even utilize SketchUp models to create their models of interest. Your hospitals, high-end buildings, this technology is now becoming more and more required to work on the project. I know some specific general contractors that they require the use of total stations by all trades on specific hospital projects to ensure that all the modeling that they've done on the front end allows for accurate installation once they get out into the field. So the only way to do that accurately and to the correct model space is utilizing a total station, especially because some of these projects are becoming more and more technically difficult to lay out with traditional methods.
So based on kind of what we've been talking about today, these have been more in commercial or residential applications for foundation systems. I'm sure that there's some steps that as we get to larger projects and things like that, that take on completely different aspects.
Definitely. We have residential, like you said, light commercial, and then we have gang forms for high-rise work. And then you talk about superstructures like bridge work. Bridge work, you start off with the pile drivers. The pile drivers start from the ground, they drive in pile or caissons, and that's going to support the gray beams, and then the columns, and the pier heads, and then of course the weight of all the bridge components and the superstructure and the weight of the bridge.
So different types of systems for different applications.
Oh, definitely. You got to pick the right forming system, otherwise you're going to be in trouble if you don't pour with the right system.
Great. Well, I appreciate your time today of taking us through these different types of forms. Thank you.
Thank you.
Behind me, we've got pile drivers driving an abutment for Gulf Road. We just finished driving a pile now. The guys are getting set up to pick up another pile and move to another location to continue driving. Pile driving, basically, in a nutshell, is below the ground foundation. You know, if you picture a high rise, as high as a building is above ground, usually you've got bearing that goes just as deep below ground. There's different types of pile that we drive. Some are friction, some would be end bearing. These happen to be friction piling. The ground here is heavy clay, so we're not having to drive them to rock. But the hammer we've got here is a smaller diesel hammer. We're driving probably about 45 to 50 foot lengths of pile. These are 14 by 89s, which would be 89 pounds a foot. This is just one of many types of piling. We'll do sheet piling, which is a complete other different operation. Used for shoring. If we're working next to a roadway and we've got a deep excavation, we'll put sheeting in and around where the guys need to work to hold back the soils. If you look next to the bridge there, they've got that concrete, looks like concrete shear face right up against the barrier wall. That was another type of shoring that we would do to help protect the roadway so we could excavate near the traffic. It takes a lot of coordination to get to this point, which involves a lot of people other than just the contractor. First was getting the right size crane, and to fit into location. The power lines are here. To the left of where the guys are driving, there's utilities underground that we have to deal with as well. So we've had people come out and locate their utilities and stuff because we don't want to get into anything that we're not supposed to. And we've got water and electric and gas main, that are potential hazards to the guys. So we've gone through and located, marked everything out. And because of the water main and whatnot, we've got our crane set up on crane mats and whatnot to protect the water main. We're the power, which is above and overhead, we've had, because we are working so close to those power, we've had ComEd come out and we're working in an outage. They've got the lines that are closest to the crane right now are dead. Those are grounded out. With us to be successful and to be competitive, my guys are usually certified welders, vast knowledge of cranes, and usually we go through quite a bit of training and rigging and whatnot, and then very good with burning and using a torch. They've rigged up an additional pile. We're using our third line, which is attached, to the crane. You've got three lines, one hooked to the hammer, one to the leads, and leads are a guide. And then the third line would be, that's hooked to the pile. They're about to pick that up.
And where we are right now is the I-90 bridge going over Mannheim Road. What we're doing is widening this road, and what is required is earth retention to support the existing bridge. Pile driving, a lot of people think of as just banging beams in the ground for support of buildings and bridges. Commonly you'll see sheeting, sheet piles. Pile drivers get into caissons, micropile. Micropile is a small version, a smaller drill shaft. Using a small drill rig, all sorts of different applications for earth retention. So we've got soldier pile and lagging that we're currently installing. The soldier pile, or the steel beams, were driven with a 100-ton crawler and a diesel hammer. Once we drive those H-pile, we install lagging. This is contact lagging, so we are shooting threaded studs onto the face of those pile. In 5-foot lifts, the excavator will dig the face of those pile, and we will install hardwood oak lagging. So this crew that we're looking at right now consists of the backhoe operator, which is a 150 operator. And then we have a composite crew of pile drivers and laborers. The pile drivers, if you look up top, he's got a chainsaw up there. The guys are hacking these big old timbers with a chainsaw. They got to muscle the boards down into the hole. You'll see a Nelson stud welding machine that we are popping these studs on. These are threaded studs. So the pile drivers are welding the studs, they're cutting the boards, they're placing the timber lagging, working in unison with the 150 operator doing the bulk of the digging, and a couple laborers doing some fine tuning. Once we're down to final cut, the bearing pile can be installed. Using the same method as the soldier pile, it's a 100 ton crawler. We'll use a diesel hammer, and we'll drive bearing H pile to a certain capacity, and the bridge will sit on those. Commonly, the pile drivers, we really need them to be good with the torch. Being a certified welder is extremely important. A lot of our work involves welding. Some of these pile go rather deep, so you have to splice onto them. You can't just do it in one piece. Welding skills, torch work, that sort of thing is needed. What attracts most people to our trade is, it's big cranes, it's heavy beams, it's a lot of action. It's a fun job. It's an adventurous job. We are on the north side of the I-90 Expressway, and this is a large widening project. They're widening both the north and south side. And what you see behind me is a retaining wall in which soil nails and shotcrete are used to stabilize the slope. The area that you see the guys drilling behind me is going to end up being the face of the MSE wall. An MSE wall is one of those puzzle piece walls that you typically see. And that wall is basically held up by straps that are embedded in compacted stone. Well, these are 33-foot drill depth shafts. We place a 7/8 bar in the shaft, we grout it, and those bars are capable of supporting about 20,000 pounds worth of load. So we'll drill these in a grid pattern, and once the soil nails are drilled and grouted, we will come back and we'll cut the face of the wall. This wall tapers down into nothing to where we're standing, but as they progress, this cut will get deeper and deeper. We will then place wire mesh and rebar and reinforce that whole area, and then we will pneumatically place concrete. So we will just spray a concrete wall. It's 4 inches thick, and together the soil nails and the bearing plates and nuts, basically sandwiching in all of the wire mesh and the rebar and the concrete, will perform the earth retention needed for that MSE wall. The soil nails are a lot like tiebex. The only difference is there's no unbonded zone at the face of the excavation, and there's no regrouts. This is a lot more cost effective than just putting in a whole mess of sheet pile. Steel is expensive. The equipment and manpower it takes to put that steel in the ground is expensive. As you can see, we've got three guys working with this gang. You've got a small tieback rig that is just drilling away. We'll let the tieback or the soil nail crew get a couple days ahead of the Shot Creek gang, and right behind them, we'll be spraying away. So the crew that we have here consists of three pile drivers and two operators. The pile driver foreman, along with another pile driver, are dealing with adding drill steel to this drill rig. They're typically about 10-foot sections, and they just keep on drilling in until they reach their final depth of 33 feet in this case. You extract all the augers, hooking them back up. You see that there's a 150 operator running the tieback rig, another 150 operator assisting the drill steel in a small mini excavator. And that is pretty much the drilling part of this. The grouting operation up on top, that is the third pile driver running the grout plant / grout silo. That silo contains about 50,000 pounds of just a powder Portland cement. We mix it with water. We pump it through a grout pump, through this hose that we're standing over, and it is tremied into the drilled shaft, filling the shaft with grout from the bottom up, getting any sort of water or debris or foreign bodies out of that shaft.
Typical in today's residential and commercial buildings is a poured concrete foundation. Except for the lack of anchor bolts, the concrete walls are supported on continuous footings. An alternative to wood or Simmons formwork is the insulated concrete form, or the ICF. Paul Camozzi of Amvic Systems explains how technology helps shape sustainability.
I guess one of the things that people always ask me is that they want to see an ICF home and they think they're going to see something different from the roadside. Once these homes are dressed out, they don't look, or commercial buildings, they don't look any different from any other methodology.
So in terms of sustainability, how do ICFs rate?
Well, that's a real hot topic for me. It's what's given me my passion in the industry for the past 20 years. As a past environmental consultant, our number one goal is to reduce CO2 in the environment. And if I can tell people we're going to reduce energy consumption in a building by 60 to 70%, I'm also reducing the amount of emissions that are going out of that building. What's interesting with the show on Built to Last, these are extremely sustainable structures because obviously we're using insulation combined with reinforced concrete. I've always maintained it's not much of a LEED Platinum building if it's laying on the ground. ICF is an acronym for insulated concrete form. Been around since the early 70s, initially the first patents for foundation work, and now we're doing everything from high-end custom homes to high-level commercial buildings.
Okay, so in terms of construction, it's kind of referred to as being part of the 8-to-1 construction methodology. What does it mean?
Well, it's probably the fundamental reason why we are gaining so much traction in the light commercial field. 8-to-1, every time we stack one of these forms, I'm giving you so many extra features that it dramatically expedites the construction process. For instance, I'm giving you insulation, I'm giving you sound attenuation, I'm giving you a place to tie your rebar, I'm giving you a furring strip for your interior and exterior attachments. I'm also giving you a perfect substrate for acrylic stucco. And last but not least, I'm giving you structure, basically the strength of the concrete.
Okay, so as part of that too, question comes up regarding air barriers and vapor barriers. Is this a product that lends itself to that as well?
Absolutely. In fact, I go back to the 8-to-1, I forgot the two. So we do have air barrier and a vapor barrier. And it's basically because of the high PERM rating on the foam and also the way the foam interlocks and pulls together. Fundamental for all high efficiency buildings is air tightness of buildings. Well, we obviously have a monolithic concrete core there. We've just ramped it up that much more by having a very impenetrable foam wall envelope on the building. So we're not doing things like Tyvek and poly. These processes are now obsolete. We don't need to, again, wrap the building or put another layer on the building. It's already all in the one step.
So what trades have adapted to using the ICF?
Historically, it was always the carpenters. And I'll tell you how it all came about. Initially, as I mentioned earlier, this was a foundation product. And if you were a carpenter doing maybe one or two homes a year, you had a hard time getting the foundation guys to come out. So something had to change. And some of these professional carpenters said, well, you know what, I'll take full control of the building, and I'll take it from footing up, and I'll control the quality. But more importantly, carpenters understand, they anticipate the other trades coming in, they've learned those various disciplines, and they also understand concrete forming. I always want to stand people up and say, this is concrete forming with all the idiosyncrasies and also some of the potential dangers of concrete forming, and carpenters tend to be better trained here.
And as part of the training process too, this is more complicated really than just stacking blocks. Obviously that's a simplified explanation, but you, like you mentioned, you are dealing with door openings, corners, bracing, and so there's a lot involved with this as far as knowing the system.
Absolutely, and again, because it is an 8-to-1 construction methodology, I always say there's about 98% planning with insulated concrete form construction and about 2% execution. So I need some intelligent, trained, well-trained people with this. We tend to sometimes get pigeonholed saying, well, it's just a Lego brick anybody can do. And I take great offense to that for a lot of reasons, because it is concrete forming. 10 of these forms is 1 cubic yard of concrete. That's about 28 pounds of hurt coming your way if you don't know what you're doing.
So where do you see the greatest applications of ICF today and kind of become part of future construction?
Well, historically, the numbers have been very strong in the northern states because, again, it's been used for concrete forming below grade. But now, as we move to more a resilient society, a stronger society, I truly believe that word resilient will be the next green wave in the United States. So now we're looking at people who are building entire mixed-use applications along coastline, et cetera, in regards to what's happening to high wind shear. Hotel, hospitality, adult lifestyle, done lots of student dormitories for universities and colleges. Basically zero maintenance buildings that are very, very strong and quiet and also environmentally friendly.
The Chicago Regional Council of Carpenters has been a vanguard for sustainability in the construction industry. Their knowledge and formwork on the job extends to the classroom where apprentices learn formwork standards and techniques. Victor Cerrone is an instructor for the apprentice and training program.
First system that we're working on is a John clamp system. A John clamp consists of 3/4 inch plywood, and you have your ties. Depending on the thickness of the wall, you'll come in and throw in your ties. Once you throw in your ties and make sure you nail this to the bottom plate, you come around to this side and you install your John clamps. Your John clamps do a couple things. The John clamps are going to take the 2x4 or receive the 2x4, and the 2x4 is going to keep the wall intact and also is going to keep the wall nice and straight.
Okay.
All right, on this side right here, you can see that we already got the 2x4s in place. We have the strong backs in place. The strong backs are going to have a brace. So that way we can plumb this thing up, so make it nice and plumb.
In addition to John clamps, Simon's forms are also a standard formwork solution in foundations today.
These are our 8-foot Simon's forms. You can use this for residential, light commercial, or even heavy commercial concrete, depending on the duty rating on the form. You can go as high as 20 feet. All you gotta do is stack them a couple 8-footers on top, and then maybe an 8-footer on top of that.
Okay.
Just make sure we reinforce them together. A little different than the plywood, it does consist of panels and clamps and ties, but they are a little different. Here we have our wedge bolt system that clamps the two forms together, and the vertical keeps this form from coming loose on you, and then you have the tie that keeps the dimension on the concrete wall.
Now, does this lend itself to doing something other than right corners and things like that as far as other shapes?
Yeah, we got here a 90 degree corner and we got a couple offsets, but if we walk over to this side of the foundation, we have a radius wall. Depending on the radius of the wall, you can use different size forms. We happen to use 10 inch on the outside. This inside radius is gonna be a smaller radius, so we gotta go with a smaller form.
Sure.
If you got, you know, a radius, it might be like a 20 foot or a 40 foot radius, you can go with 2 foot panels, depending how neat you want that radius to look.
So yes. This lends itself to do other shapes and sizes as well.
Yeah, we are kind of limited though, compared to plywood, because those odd angles, and now we do have hinge corners.
Sure.
We can make any angle that we want. At the same time, they're not as versatile as a piece of plywood. You can have a piece of plywood or anything that you want, any dimension, any angle. This is where you fill in the concrete. This is where you pour the concrete. And of course, you got to establish the top of the concrete, the elevation.
Okay, now how would they go about that? Is that marked on here, or how do you maintain knowing what level you need to pour the wall to?
Well, we got to do some numbers with the benchmark.
Sure,
okay. Whether it's with a total station, a transfer, or a laser, we just got to shoot the elevation according to the benchmark. The benchmark is going to tell us the height of this wall compared to anything on a work site.
Okay, so it doesn't necessarily mean you come in here and you pour the concrete to the top of the form. It might be set somewhere down to a different level from there.
Yes, most of the time your top of the foundation is going to be somewhere inside of the foundation, because it would be real difficult to make this foundation completely level all the way around. Okay. It's almost impossible.
Finally, part of training is dedicated to an alternative formwork, the insulated concrete form, and the benefits to its application.
IFCFs happens to be the forming system that you would pick if you want to go into a green building.
Wow.
Because what it is just a solid concrete wall.
Sure.
You can start in the basement, go up to the first floor, or even the second floor. They've done hotels up to 7 to 9 stories with these kind of ICFs.
So it's not necessarily just a foundation. You could kind of continue this through for the whole structure.
Oh, you definitely can. The nice thing about this too is that if you're inside of the basement, if you guys want to walk in here,
sure,
and then I'll show you inside of a room, inside of a basement, first floor, you can walk in here and throw on your drywall right away.
Okay.
And the reason you throw in your drywall is because if you look, you have your tie that you can screw right into that. So you don't need to frame anything. No wood, no metal, you can just screw it right to here and you have a drywall.
So basically this system eliminates a couple steps that normally would take place.
Right, no framing.
Sure.
No insulating.
Right.
Because this is the insulation. On the outside walls, you don't need to insulate.
So these kind of, they just stack in place and I assume you just, you try to offset your joints and things like that?
Yeah, the whole trick to this whole system is to keep your ties aligned.
Okay.
If you keep your ties aligned, the seams will stagger by themselves.
Okay.
Otherwise, it would just come apart when you pour the concrete.
Sure.
A little bit more bracing for this type of system, and when you pour, you gotta pour in layers. The first couple, 3 feet, go all the way around this whole pour, come up again another 4 feet, and then top off to the very top, depending on the height.
I'm Bruce Obora. Thank you for watching this episode of Built to Last.
Visit the Built to Last website to learn about these topics and more.